Yeah, so at the bottom, do you see that little icon for projecting in the very bottom right?
I don't.
On your slides. Yeah, right there. Yeah, try that.
All right, looks like we're in business.
Yeah.
Thanks. All right.
Hi, everyone. Welcome.
And can you see them? Can you see them joining, Elisa?
I can, yeah. Okay. You should be able to, too, if you click on participants at the bottom. It should open a window and you can see who's here. So we've got a smaller group so far. It's summer. I think a lot of people are taking vacations right around now. So, but I bet people will catch up on the video later. So it looks like there's about 13 folks in the room. But that's nice. It'll be a nice intimate discussion.
Absolutely.
Sometimes those are the best ones. Cool. It looks like it's kind of steadied off. So do you guys want to jump in?
Yeah, absolutely. So thank you for joining us today. This is the book review for Chapter 7, Learning in the Digital Age, Assistive Technology and Electronic Access. I'm Grace Clifford. I'm the Director of Disability and Testing Services at Cleveland State and contributed to this chapter.
Hi, everyone. I'm Linda Sullivan. I am the 504 coordinator for Dartmouth College. My relation in the book says Harvard University, and I just recently changed jobs, so that explains that. Thrilled that you all joined us today.
So we do like to take this time to thank all the contributing authors to the book, and this is a list of those who contributed. Additionally, I'd like to thank those who co-sponsored this book club, including the Coalition, AHEAD, Springer Publishing, and Designated Interpreters. For engaging in the discussion today, if you have a question or a comment, use the raise hand icon or option on Zoom, and the moderator will unmute you so that you can contribute to the discussion. Additionally, if you need closed captioning or would like to use closed captioning, click the CC button at the bottom of the screen, or if you don't see that because you're on a smaller device, there should be an option that says more with three little dots, and you should be able to select captioning from there. All right, so if there's not any questions, we'll get going. For the first question, for this book review, it says, in order to collaborate more effectively on technology accessibility, the disability office at your institution should be knowledgeable about and involved in the process of accessibility evaluations with your institution's information technology or IT professionals. We'd like to discuss the opportunities for collaboration between disability resource providers and IT professionals to provide accessible technology for students with disabilities. This is in the book talked about on page 193 in table 7.1, opportunities for collaboration technology. So would ever like to kick it off and tell us a little bit about the collaborations at your institution. That'd be great.
So why don't I start with just a few little things to add to this to kind of get the conversation going. One of the things that's really important is that disability resource professionals understand that they don't have to know how to provide web accessibility evaluations. You really just need to know what is involved in it and what the outcome should be. So there's lots of checklists that you can find online. You can go to the World Wide Web Consortium, where you can find checklists on WCAG 2.1 and 2.0, AA, single A or triple A, as well as 508 and the updates that occurred there. And those will help you have really robust conversations with your IT professionals at your institutions, because they want to be the ones who are actually looking at the accessibility of their web designs, web presence, because they're the ones who can fix them. Most often disability offices don't have the bandwidth to take that on. And so it can be a little difficult when everybody's saying, well, this is the disability office, when it really isn't. It's a collaborative process between the disability office and the IT group on campus.
Has anybody, you know, worked on these types of initiatives before? And if so, you know, who are the individuals you go to or collaborate with, you know, at your institution? All right, I see some raised hands.
So I unmuted Maria.
Hello, this is Maria. So I can share a little bit of what we've done in trying to look at the technology. So we have an assistive technology specialist in our team. So we are trying to move from being responsive to a complaint or an issue to really being proactive and ensuring that things are compliant to begin with. So like I'm one of the UC schools, so now we're also, one of the things he's tasked with now is also working with the UC system to ensure that we're trying to get licenses for everything. And when purchasing softwares, that they are as compliant as possible. In addition to things like that, we've worked with, like even today, this morning, we had a meeting with some of our multimedia technology support teams to try to create dual mode instruction environments. Not just one where the students can hear what's going on, but that they can be an active participant in case there's those didactic elements to the course. So we were even testing all that out. We've done even like an internet test for all the main classrooms on campus, because we can have all this remote and internet capabilities, but if we don't have Wi-Fi that works, we're dead in the water. So, I mean, we did a big Wi-Fi study right before the pandemic. The good thing is that we had those results so we can start working on solutions while we were all in remote. So we've been able to do that. We do try to provide, and we have provided, and it almost feels like we're preaching to the choir, you know, accessibility workshops to faculty who are interested. We do host Census Access on our website for any student or faculty who wants to use it. We also try to convince faculty that once we've created accessibility as something that's accessible for them, to keep it for the next group of students instead of having to do a one-off each time. That's just one of the things that we've done. But we'll see what happens when we go back, see.
Yeah. And for the Wi-Fi study and the accessibility workshops, do you partner with like your education technology departments or with your faculty development office or anything like that? Or is it something that your office kind of takes a charge on your own?
All of it. We've worked with multimedia technologies with Excite, which is our instructional technology team. We were working with them on how to create remote, like, accessible online classes before the pandemic. So it's like we were almost ready to shift to remote if we needed to. So we've had a really good working relationship. I think one of the positive things of this pandemic is that many offices had already seen us as a resource for that. So we became a go-to for many, like, instructors, instructional teams, development teams. So we're trying to get our hands in every single pot so people remember that accessibility is a thing.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. And your story sounds a lot, I think a lot of disability resource providers have a similar story where it starts off as, you know, responding to things that were, you know, aren't accessible and it would be a barrier for a student. And then you're like, it'd be great if we could be proactive and get out there and do a little bit more. So you become kind of that information hub. So, you know, one of the things we talked about at my institution is the difference between accommodation and accessibility and why inherent accessibility is still required and not necessarily just the job of the disability resource office, but, you know, it's phenomenal when you are such a resource for so many and that they respect you and buy in that way.
Thank you.
So I also see Brian's hand.
Sure. So I've worked on technology issues in disability for a little over 10 years, and I've done everything from working on our system level policy to co-authoring our it was a 5-year plan. Now it's a 5-phase plan about making sure that things are born accessibly. And because this got to be too big for our campus, we actually started a separate office from the DRC office. So we have an office of accessibility resources that is there really teaching those universal design principles. But from a day-to-day perspective, we have really good contacts in IT looking at our software and our learning management system, right? Are the right things going into there, and do people know how to navigate them? And then a lot of our health science programs have universally proctored exams where the instructor may not be doing it, but the college may be doing it. So having a contact with that testing person who's actually setting up the exams to make sure that your accommodations and your extra time can be put in place. And then talking to everybody in purchasing, not only about your software and hardware purchases, but can you start to put pressure on your vendors and your textbook providers? Because we still have a whole team here, and I love them, they do great work, providing hundreds of textbooks each semester in alternate formats. And if the publishers can do that when they're building the textbooks, then it saves us the time and money of having to redo it when it gets here for student needs.
Yeah, that's awesome. And that's why I feel like living the dream when a separate office is created out of your efforts and you have institutional buy-in at that level.
Well, honestly, we had some really difficult situations, and people said if there was one thing we could do to let us have fewer difficult situations, what would it be? And I said, somebody to focus on electronic accessibility, and they gave us a line, and then the line grew into an office.
That's awesome. All right. Any other collaborations that anyone wants to talk about?
And I'll note that Will also put in the chat while I'm opening his line that he's worked with various individuals on campus to consult with web newsletters, programming, et cetera, to provide best practices in web content, which sounds awesome. I hope he's going to tell us more about that.
Hi, yes, I work with, I'm at UC as well. I work with Maria, and one of the things that we've also done was, so I partner with Excite when they give, we have a teaching credential program on campus, and so we do presentations for each one of their sessions. They do a fall, and I think a winter session or spring session, and we go talk and go in and talk about the technology that they will see students using and how they can help better prepare their materials, make sure their materials are accessible for them to reduce the lag time in getting students the content that they need. It's been really helpful.
That's awesome.
That's great.
Yeah. All right. So the only other office I would probably mention that we hadn't talked about is our office works a lot with student engagement, which does like student activities and leadership type things. Because the other place we see a lot of digital accessibility barriers is, you know, newsletters, flyers, things put out by student organizations and groups. So we've been trying to create mini trainings and opportunities for student employment to kind of be dispersed out to those student groups to talk about, you know, little things they can do to make things inherently more accessible and what the resources are on campus to help them make documents accessible for events. All right. So we'll move along to the next question just to stay on time. All right, Linda.
Sure. So our next question has a few parts. We really want to start talking and thinking about the technologies used for teaching and learning in the classroom. Every institution has different ones, so hearing from all of you what those look like would be really helpful. And the benefit for each students with disabilities and those without, because we know that technologies have different impacts for different learners. You know, and so within that, we'd like to hear about some of the potential barriers that flipped classrooms can present for students with disabilities, and then the dreaded exam process that so many students and faculty have kind of bemoaned since COVID got going. So how does administering exams and quizzes online, you know, what are the benefits and the drawbacks for disabled students and then for faculty? Anybody have any thoughts on that?
Some of the benefits for having the online classes or the even just quizzes, just having the quizzes online. If they're using, depending on which learning management system they're using, there's a lot of accessibility built into it, and or at least checks. So if they have a question about something that comes up, they can contact us to figure out what do they need to do. But in general, most of them, there are built, as I would say, some built-in accessibility. So that reduces some of the conversions that we have to do as far as exams are concerned. Some of the drawbacks is that, you know, it's online, so instructors can, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning, just like students do, 2 o'clock in the morning, oh, I've got a thought, or I read this nice article and I'm scanning a PDF and it's an image-based PDF, and so it's not accessible. And to help remedy some of those issues, we've, again, like Maria talked about, we've subscribed to Census Access, so the student and or the faculty can run those documents through and at least get something that's available that the students, that all students can use. And if it needs to be cleaned up, then we can help that way. And it's 24/7, so they don't have to wait to make an appointment to make it a, you know, 1 hour appointment that usually takes 5 minutes. But so those are some of the things that's helped. Just the teachers in general, the instructors in general, becoming more familiar with some of the technology that their instructor, that their students are using, has been great. So a lot of times they're coming to us. I'm working with, especially with our science department, they're actually coming to myself or someone in the office before they get ready to do some new project or something else online to have it reviewed before they spend the time on it, or what things that they need to look for when they're. Especially some of like the simulation type programs, some of them are accessible, some of them are totally not accessible. So it's been great to see that as well. They're being more proactive. I think just more proactive.
I think that would definitely be one of the positives that's come out of COVID and all of us being moved to an online world is there's been, at least in my experience, there's been more proactivity on the part of faculty when it comes to online content, because it's pretty hard to teach a class if nobody can get to it. So that's been a good thing.
And I see that Brian added in the chat.
One of the things Will. Okay. One I wanted to mention was for students themselves, some of the barriers are just, you know, I see it now in the chat. Bandwidth, internet connectivity, you know, not having a hotspot, things like that are really hindering some of our students. We're really hindering some of our students.
Yeah, it sounds like you and Brian are on the same wavelength, where he was also noting the challenges that include bandwidth, equipment, environment, and academic integrity issues as well. But he notes the benefits are increased ease and flexibility.
And in our institution, you know, I agree with it helps faculty be more proactive. You know, being in this forced remote environment has caused them to pay a little bit more attention. We actually had some temporary grant funding. So we brought on an individual that's a disability access specialist, and it was specifically a faculty point person. And although the idea was that if there was an on-ground class, you know, they could help with implementing accommodations there as well, you know, during COVID times, you know, most of the questions were about, you know, how to set things up with for accommodations in the learning management system. We did start to do some training as well, and we have Blackboard Ally, and we use that similar to the Census Access to help faculty be more aware of what that means, you know, what that's telling them in that little kind of gauge, and how, you know, our office can help them improve that or work through that. So I think that was certainly a benefit. Something that I've seen come up with flipped classrooms is probably less of a positive is sometimes processing time can be, you know, if a student has a processing delay, that could be a more difficult environment for them. They don't necessarily feel in a group, you know, because it's quite often a group environment, that they have the time to fully process the information in the way that they would in a traditional classroom if they could study or prepare ahead of time. Also, students with chronic illnesses, you know, if they need to miss class, you know, those classes tend to be, you miss a day, you miss a lot. And so there's fewer absences permitted sometimes, and that can be difficult for students as well.
All right. So Emily had her hand up.
I was going to echo about the flipped classrooms with the processing for students in how that could be some of those barriers.
that a student would experience. But as for the first part of the question in discussing the technologies used for teaching and learning in the classroom, as many instructors obviously are using is Zoom and recording those lectures. And so what I'm hearing from some students is that in the classes where they have the lectures available early, that they are pre-listening to those lectures, creating some notes, creating some outlines for themselves, so then they're able to be more engaged with the lecture as it actually goes on. And then conversely, at the end of class, a lot of students are talking about listening back to the lectures again, but at that 1.5 pace or the 2 pace, so that they're able to get through it faster, but still go back and listen to anything that they may have missed. And that's also for any student with or without a disability, which I think is really helpful.
You know, one of the things that we ran into, this was even pre-COVID, we had a couple of situations where students were feeling, especially in a testing situation where it was intrusive, to have a third party watching them that they couldn't see. I know that we've also run into problems where students with certain psychiatric conditions felt very, like their conditions became very exacerbated by the unknown presence of an other watching over them. So those were some things that we had to kind of needle our way through.
Yeah, I had some students also reference it as feeling like, you know, their social anxiety in a classroom, they could remove themselves, put themselves at the back of the classroom, be somewhat removed, have their planned exit, whereas it feels like you're under a microscope, especially when you can see your video and see the video of everybody else. So that could be an exacerbation for them as well.
This is Maria again. One of the things that we did for situations like that is that we were supporting the idea of having a and if it was a Zoom type of proctoring, it's like create a separate breakout room for this student. So like that provided them the reduced distraction. And if it, within that breakout room, they were still being distracted by their own image, we would instruct the student on how to turn off their own image so they wouldn't have to see it. I mean, it'd still be available to the faculty, and after a few minutes, they'd forget. So it was a way to help. I mean, it was more disability management in teaching the student how to be how to have that private space so they don't feel like they're just being watched.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're being watched, but they don't feel it because they're not seeing right. their own video.
Yeah. And I think that's the key thing. And just like you said, the disability management piece. The other thing we did at first when we went remote, there was a push to just engage like with ProctorU and have a third party testing agency handle it. At Cleveland State, we have a centralized testing center, and we hadn't done remote exams previously, but we did see the benefit in having the students with, you know, extreme types of social anxiety or anxiety be remote proctored by someone that they know. They used to go to our testing center, you know, when they were on campus. And also, you know, if there was a disability episode or something during an exam, it was trained individuals for how to kind of walk them through that, not just somebody who is paid to watch somebody take a test. So we developed some remote proctoring services within our testing services as well, just for those students that felt more comfortable with our staff.
Great. All right. Well, we are really getting into the thick of it. So Grace, I'm going to have us move forward and let you take the next question.
Yeah, absolutely. So question 3, in order for disability resource providers to be able to select appropriate assistive technology to remove barriers for students, they must acquire and maintain knowledge of available and new assistive technology. What are some ways that a disability resource office can achieve this? So this one's always an interesting one, because I know you talk to some individuals in some schools, and it seems like there's a pretty robust budget for assistive technology and has assistive technology labs. And then others are just kind of scraping together kind of what they need for a particular student. So be interested to know how many on the call today have an assistive technology lab or an assistive technology specialist as part of this question.
I'm an access specialist, accessible technology specialist, and some of the things I do is I'm on several two or three listservs that I pretty much am on every day, and there's always something about either new technology that's out there or with a different way of using it. I talk about there's ways that I use different technologies. Myself, there's something out there that I've seen on a website, I'll immediately contact the vendor and say, hey, can I get a copy? Can I get even if it's a basic copy, I'll limit it out, see how it works. And not just for how it works or how's the student going to interact with it. What platforms does it work on? You know, what are going to be the differences between using it on iOS versus a Windows machine? And we don't have a lab, an AT lab itself. It's just myself. And same with the budget. I've co-wrote a grant for our census access through our student technology fees. They're offered our grants. And so we're able to get a grant to pay for that for a few years. But otherwise, it's mostly just going online, seeing what's available and testing it out myself. See how it works, and see how can I integrate it into what our students are particularly using, or what their barriers are.
And when you contact the vendors, well, do you usually ask for a trial, or do you get you just purchase one to try out, or
new users? There's never a purchase involved. It's always a trial version. I'm looking for.
That's very cool. Yeah, I know that was really helpful to our office during COVID, because one of the issues we ran into, which was part of the last question, was a lot of the lockdown browsers that the faculty chose for academic integrity purposes would block out like Read and Write Gold and some of the other things we use. Right. So, you know, at the time we'd already missed our window for our student tech fee purchases. And luckily Read Speaker was willing to give us a trial because they were newer to the market and, you know, we could really show the value add for the institution. So that trial was a heaven sent for sure.
Yeah. And one of the things as far as AT, when it comes, especially if it's coming out of anyone's budget, one of the things I try to do is to figure out how does this help benefit all students or any student on campus, or how can we use, you know, how can faculty use this? How can students use it? And use it, that's probably a better way to go about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's always to get more buy-in.
Yeah, and that's always helpful too, especially when the institutional, you know, price for it is fairly affordable. If you can throw that out there, when we were first switching to Read and Write Gold at my previous institution, similar thing, we partnered with another office and said, you know, all students then could use it if we just do the institutional fee. So that's a good tip. All right. A couple other hands, it looks like.
Cindy, do you want to chime in?
Sure. At Rutgers, as large as we are, we have three or four different offices of disability services, but our AT is centralized. So we have one centralized office that provides AT support for all of our campuses. At my previous position, we did have an AT lab at a community college, and I was the person that was in charge of the AT lab. But I'm so glad that Rutgers has this centralized service for a lot of reasons. But one of the reasons is that technology just moves so quickly. I feel like the last 5 years, I've gone from knowing so much about AT and being in charge of it to knowing barely anything because things have moved so quickly. So it's been a very interesting time, but it's great to have others take over that. I've stayed up with the AT as best I can because I am on a lot of those listservs that somebody previously mentioned, but there are others who are in charge of intaking students and assessing their technology needs.
Yeah. I feel like Linda and I were joking about this when we were preparing for this, like Echo Smart Pens was like the best thing since sliced bread, you know, when you first came to the field. And, you know, certainly a lot of students still get some benefit from it, but certainly seems kind of like old and archaic technology compared to, you know, a lot of the things we're seeing nowadays. All right. Any other contributions? Awesome. We'll move on to the next question. Turn over to Linda.
Okay. So this kind of dovetails off of what we were just talking about. So when is it the university's responsibility for paying for assistive technology? And when is it the students? I know this is something that lots of universities struggle with. I myself have struggled with this in my offices over the years. You know, plus the opportunities that might exist at your institution to develop the AT trial loan program or an AT lab. So I'd like to hear people weigh in on that a little bit.
So I see that Terry wrote in the chat that requests for note-taking services have decreased drastically over the last few years. However, I've granted money specifically for note-taking services. Any recommendations on how the $4,000 can be used creatively? Anyone can email me directly, and she put her email address there. In the meantime, I'll go ahead and open Will's mic so he can chime in as well. But while he's getting his unmuted, does anybody want to respond to Terry? Note-taking
Express. I was actually going to, part of my answer, part of my answer may be part of a solution.
Okay.
Yes. One of the things that we do, we've, so through that grant, like I say, Census Access, we were able to use part of our budget to purchase licenses for Otter for as a note-taking tool, Otter Voice Notes, and it's worked out really well. And what I do is I loan it out to the student for a full semester, and we use Clockwork as our system management. So I use it through that program, so that way I track what's going on. Otter also has a dashboard, so I can see if students are truly using it to its capability, as far as a licensed version is concerned versus the free version. I often start with these types of softwares where what's a subscription as a software as a subscription, have them try the free version first to see if it's going to work for them, if they're actually using it to the level of a subscription version before I loan it out, because we have limited licenses. And that's one of the first, again, like one of the first things for note taking. There are several programs out there. They all do a few different things. I have smart pens, Echo smart pens. I use one of the things that I've been recommending for students that use iOS is Notability. It's a $10 program app. We don't cover that cost at this time, but it's relatively minimal cost for the student. They have it forever. It's something they can use forever. Not just here, but when they move on. That might be something that you could use that 4K for as buyers. I'm on a, our university system, UC system, is working with several vendors through an RFP for assistive software purchases and using the power of our campuses in the state to get some better deals instead of, you know, having one campus or college having three different accounts. Then, you know, we can use that power to get better deals for all students, for student use. And I would say, as far as the in responding to Terry, what types of technology access do your students have? Are they just using their mobile devices? Are they using tablets? Are they using actual computers? And I would start there first to see what kind of software I would use that money to purchase. Because if you just go out and buy, let's say, for example, if you go out and buy, you know, I don't know, 50 licenses of Otter, maybe students aren't really using their mobile device. They're only using if they're in class, they're using their laptops. It may not work as well for them as opposed to using it on their tablet or mobile device. So that's just something to think about.
Great suggestions, Bob.
And to address the other part, the who pays, I think it really goes back to, I mean, is it a personal item, or is it something that is required to gain access to the academic environment? Like, for example, we loan out equipment, but we don't necessarily give it away. But if student wants to have their own, they're welcome to buy it, privately, not through us. We will lend out FM systems. And if a student needs an FM system, that we are required to have and to lend out. But if a student really wants a smart pen, but we don't have any more, I mean, the accommodation is they get to record. How they get to do it is creative means. We do have some tools that we can lend out on a first come, first go, checkout basis. If we're talking about something more like Zoom text or that student, a student that's blind may need, as long as we have it in available within the university systems that the student needs to be using it in, that's where we purchase the software, but we don't put it on their personal computer and now they own it. So we're looking at softwares that we can check out to make the academic environment accessible, but we will not purchase equipment for students. We're lending it out.
That's a really interesting feature or conversation, I should say, especially when we get to licenses. I know that there have been times where we had students who needed certain programs, let's just say JAWS or something like that, to use in a classroom setting, but then they also needed it for their homework setting. And so the law says we're only required to pay for it for in the classroom, but we're not going to take it off their computer, you know, so that it really does become this kind of tightrope that we all walk. So it's a good conversation. Lots to think about there. Thank you, Maria.
That's why we use licenses to check out on a semester, on a quarter by quarter basis.
Yeah. And I know someone mentioned or referenced kind of getting some funding from the institutions, like tech fees for the students. Sometimes that can be a really interesting way to get funding for a trial or loan program. So the institution I was at previously, you know, didn't tend to have the same, the students didn't tend to have the same need as the one I'm at currently. We have a lot of students that have very significant financial burdens, as well as, you know, home insecurity, food insecurity, and things like that. So the institution is invested in minimizing additional costs to students. So, you know, that's how we've kind of developed our trial and loan program. You know, when Echo Smart Pens were big, we bought a robust, you know, number of them so that we could, you know, loan them out semester to semester. Whereas my previous institution, we loaned it out for like one semester so they could get a feel for, you know, if they liked it, if they were going to actively use it, because some students, you know, never kind of bought in fully and then it just sat in their backpack. But, you know, if they liked it, we recommended that they purchase it, especially because it's a fairly inexpensive piece of technology. I know at Cleveland State, one of the big things that we've done is invest in the various types of amplified stethoscopes so that our AT specialists can work with students to find out which one works best with their cochlear implants and the environments they're in. So we have kind of varieties, but same thing, we own them. They don't stay with the students after their time at CSU is done.
The only thing I wanted to add to the conversation is I do think that COVID made things a little bit more complicated. We are a graduate health science campus and our students were not on campus or in clinicals for a lot of last year. And so they didn't have access to campus resources. So even our library shut down for a really long period of time. So for instance, I have a student who has a low vision issue and she was working from this tiny little laptop in her dorm room and she couldn't, even with the accessibility features, she couldn't magnify things big enough on that small screen. And so what she had done in the past is, you know, use different classrooms that were available for studying on campus or go to the library and use resources there. And none of those things were available. So likewise, we loan equipment, but I made arrangements to loan her a monitor so that she could attach it to her laptop and blow stuff up big enough so that she could see it. And that's not something I typically would have done. But, you know, that's just one example of with COVID, how things changed a little bit to help students continue to have access during that time period.
Yeah, that's a creative solution to the problem. We did a similar thing where we had students, you know, the institution as a whole, we had a number of students who just didn't have regular access to Wi-Fi and laptops. So they ordered in a number of laptops and hotspots to loan out, and had like a drive-through system to pick them up. And so we made sure any student that had AT needs that their computers were outfitted with the appropriate items, which typically we wouldn't handle that way. But we did in extreme situations and need situations, take things out of our AT lab and loan them out to students, just because that was going to be the quickest way to get them what they need. So definitely the pandemic has made us thriftier and quick to be creative and respond. So
I want to draw everyone's attention to some suggestions for resources that are in the chat. Paul Harwell mentioned Brian mentioned that Paul Harwell has some presentations on the AHEAD website. Two different people mentioned Voc Rehab as a potential resource for financial support for a student. And we'll put a link to a Trello board, which I just opened and is really awesome. So definitely open that right now from his link, so it'll still be open on your computer when we close this Zoom and you don't lose access to that. And you can bookmark it for yourself. So I just wanted to be sure people saw those things before I hand it back to you guys.
Awesome, thanks. And in the interest of time, we should probably move along to the next question. So for question number 5, discuss some AT tools available for use with students with visual disabilities, for deaf of hard of hearing students, for reading or other learning disabilities. So we touched on this a little bit, but if we have additional thoughts and contributions, that would be awesome. So for, visual disabilities, one kind of cool AT tool that we were trying out in our office, you know, I'll jump in and get things started, was we did get one of the sign glasses, and we specifically were using that for a student that was in a field experience. It was an education, but, you know, they had to divide their time between kind of classroom management as well as, having access to their sign language interpreter and their line of sight. So that was kind of an interesting creative tool. I wouldn't say they are the most cost-effective option right now, but it was a new and innovative way to approach it. And I think, you know, with our student tech fees, we got a pair of the glasses and could use it with our own vendor for like $1,000 or $1,500. So that was one cool tool that we tried out. We were sure we'll run into some things that are less awesome about it, but we enjoyed trying that out for students with visual disabilities needing sign language interpreters while maintaining their line of sight. For individuals working with students with reading or other learning disabilities, are mostly working with Read and Write Gold, Kurzweil, and, you know, if you have one versus the other, what do you like about the product and what not so much?
Well, for example, I'll share even for myself. I am one of those that has ADHD and I lose my place when I'm reading and all that good stuff. I don't like any of those tools. I like Natural Reader, where I can literally highlight one paragraph at a time or one line at a time and not lose my space. Because of ADHD, also things where like Kurzweil or where you just throw in your all the text and have it read to you, you lose focus. So gives you there's a lot of different tools, but they all work very differently. So I really like Natural Reader, not just as a reading tool, but also as a writing improvement tool. So back to ADHD and disorganization, you can have your own reading and writing read back to you. And I've taught many graduate students how to use it in that way. And it's really been a life changer for them. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of great tools that will read your textbook to you, but it's that surgical approach to it that can give you more dedicated attention that I think is also really, when we're identifying an AT tool, I mean, just throwing a standard name of what works for one person, that's not enough. It really goes back to trying to figure out how are these tools different and what works for what student. Mm-hmm. Because Kurzweil is great. I know a lot of people like it, but some people become overwhelmed by it.
Yeah, Yeah, it's actually the institution I was at previously, we had Kurzweil, and when the contract came up for a new, you know, that's when we checked out Read and Write Gold. And what led me to switch was Read and Write, you know, although it's web-based, all of the features that if you need help learning to kind of use them or enact them, there's little quick tutorial, like it's 3 minutes or less videos, because they know about that attention span. And as somebody who also has ADHD, I liked that. It also had the screen masker tool, which is, you know, what you were referencing in Naturally Reader, where you can go word by word, line by line, paragraph by paragraph, you know, you can totally customize it to what works best for you. And it has a lot of the other things you talked about, like the ability to write and have it read back to you. So if you haven't done a trial of one of that, that has a lot of really fun features that are similar to what you've been mentioning.
Yeah, well, and the thing about Natural Reader, you could just download the toolbar and it's free. So yeah, that's one a benefit. That students can use anywhere, whereas Kurzweil is it's pretty expensive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's why I will say the Read and Write, that was the other thing, the institutional membership for Read and Write that allowed us to actually offer it to all students at my previous institution was the other reason we looked at that. That was a little bit more affordable. But I know Linda too had some things about Kurzweil that she thought was interesting for a particular group of students.
So one of the things, I've always been a big proponent of Read and Write. I think it just offers a lot of tools for lots of different disabilities. I think what Maria was saying was really important, that we really have to contextualize where the functional limitation is for the student and how the AT is working. And to that end, this is my one big plug for Kurzweil, is that it's not web-based. So when you have a student going abroad, and I ran into this many, many times, sending them abroad with Read and Write was particularly ineffective if they were in a country where the Wi-Fi was questionable. So being able to convert those files before they went, they could use that tool no matter where they were and still keep up with their studies. So there are some, again, it's that contextual piece. We really just have to think about how it all fits together.
This is Brian from UNLV. What I wanted to say is I think the most important thing is any assistive technology is going to have a learning curve. And the biggest challenge that I have with students is getting them to invest the time to get past the learning curve. And one of the ways that my staff and I do that is we talk about not only what are you going to be using for this course or this semester or even your academic experience, but what tools are you going to need to succeed as a professional? And it really is sitting down and thinking through all of the different pieces, right? What's it going to mean to read a lot of material, right, consistently, effectively? What is it going to mean to be able to put your case notes in an EMR system, right? Because let's say Dragon Naturally Speaking is one of the best and most life-changing technologies for people who have those needs. But if you're going to use all of the features, you're going to be spending a lot of time getting familiar with Dragon Naturally Speaking, right? You can get started in 3 minutes with quick start training, but to be an effective user, you're going to spend a lot of that time. The same if you're going to use all of the features with Read and Write Gold or with Kurzweil, right? I like Kurzweil for large documents like textbooks because you really can mark up and track and follow all 500 pages of your textbook. But it really is getting people, a lot of our students are coming in with no assistive technology experience. So the first time they're dealing with that is in our college and university setting.
Brian, you make some great points there. And I would actually add to that when we're making recommendations to students, this was told to me by our Office of General Counsel, when we make the recommendation to the student to use a particular AT tool, we have the responsibility to train the student how to do it. So it's one thing when the student comes to us and says, I want Kurzweil or I want Read and Write. But if we say to the student, gee, we really think that you would be better off with Kurzweil, then we have a responsibility to teach them how to use it and make sure that they're using it effectively. So it puts a lot of onus back on the disability resources.
Linda, let me ask for a little context. Are they saying, if you're saying that's the only way to make material accessible, that you have to do the training?
there, what was said to me, and again, this was said to me by one of our attorneys at my former institution, that when we make recommendations to a student about the kinds of assistive technology that would alleviate their barrier, then we have the responsibility to teach them how to use it.
Interesting. I've never heard that before. What we do and how we frame it with our language is that we will do a basic orientation, but if somebody needs more than that, then we would refer to our Bureau of Services for the Blind or our Bureau of Vocational Rehabilitation or our a lot of your states will have state AT funds that fund local programs that their mission is to train on assistive technology. So the truth is we do a lot of orientation, right? My AT specialist will spend more time than he should with folks. I will say one last thing. If you're looking for a way to get some technology on your campus, making the pitch for that campus-wide license for Read and Write Gold is huge, because here's the thing. Anybody that's affiliated, whether a student, faculty, or staff member can use that. And you can really, if you can build the coalition, right, you could get your struggling students to use it, your first years, your international students, and students with disabilities. And so the pitch I've made specifically to our athletics is we have students who, because of stigma and fear, may never come into the DRC office. But if everybody on the team bus has and is using Read and Write Gold, then they're just another team member using another tool. Again, we've got a lot of work to do on my campus. And if anybody's done a big rollout that's been successful with thousands of users on your campus, please contact me.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and those vocational rehabilitation options are a great option. They have some really great in-depth training. I think the biggest barrier we see is sometimes making sure that student gets connected and that the time delay doesn't occur. Because that's a big thing is that, you know, if it takes, you know, 2 months for the student to get in and they're already partway through their academic semester, that's where it can get tricky. And that's where I think more of the onus falls on a disability office. And that's typically what, you know, we've used as kind of leverage to advocate for assistive technology lab space, as well as an assistive technology individual, just because they can devote time to that and they can follow up with the students, see how it's going. So we use it for a risk management in addition to a student support piece. So I'm going to move along to question six, because I know we're short on time. Linda?
So often including accessibility for students with disabilities is overlooked when systems like electronic health records, EHRs, are customized for an institution's use. Let's discuss how your institution ensures accessibility to EHRs for students with disabilities and the DRP's role in this, if there is one. If accommodations for EHR access are required, in addition to the student's need, what other considerations does the disability resource professional need to keep in mind when determining the accommodations? And we have table two to the common barriers, that 7.2, that kind of identifies a lot of this for us.
So any individuals on the call have experience with this? All right, I see Cindy raised her hand, perfect.
One of the things that keep in mind is that you may have to look for multiple solutions because different hospitals or health centers use different EMRs or EHRs. We had a student who couldn't use her hands to type because of sensitivity. I don't remember what the whole issue was, but we worked with the school and the hospital's technology team, and they were able to find solutions, but it wasn't just one solution. We had to go from hospital to hospital. It was a medical student, and adjust each EMR. And I think that for the most part, the student was able to use Dragon, but we also had to look at HIPAA issues and other things, you know, a private place for her to use Dragon. And it was very, very complex. But it was a good learning process for my office as well as for the school in general.
Mm-hmm. And it always seems that the situations that are the most daunting on the onset are the ones you learn the most from and you feel the most confident after. You know, with these accessibility of EHRs, you know, what I've found is that when you can be proactive and get out way in front of it, you know, that's super helpful. I know with my previous institution, when our medical school started including language about, you know, as part of the admission process, outreach to the disability office, talk to them about what you might need, that gave us the opportunity to say, hey, you know, we have a student coming in, we have this need, but let's look at what this might take to put it together. So we had a good solid year before we had to worry about, you know, that aspect, so we could work through things without that pressure. Because, you know, when it's time sensitive, that doesn't always put everybody in the best mood. So but what I've found is that being as proactive as possible is helpful, but also encouraging the student to be proactive in thinking about what their needs will be, you know, a good semester before something comes, you know, to see you as a resource, as a disability office, and to continually kind of bounce back and, you know, keep that conversation going. Other experiences with accessibility in EHRs? So in the interest of time, we'll move along, but I will say there's a great table on this on page 213 in the book that talks about all the different things. One of the things it highlights is sometimes even simple solutions like identifying a particular station to make accessible for a student, or using an iPad because the iPad has so many inherent accessibility features. So, you know, if this comes up, you know, despite the fact that I've contributed to this book, it's something I pull off my shelf more days when something comes up to reference and look back to. So definitely check out that table. So for question 7, what are some emerging technologies that are replacing previously hands-on learning methods in health science curriculums? And how has the use of these emerging technologies improved the learning experience for students with and without disabilities? And how was the technology assessed for accessibility prior to acquisition? So this is multiple steps. And what I'm most interested in is probably the last question, you know, how it was accessed or if it was accessed for accessibility prior to acquisition by your institution. While we're waiting for someone to interject an example, I have is our institution was one of the first to get the HoloLens at my previous institution, Case Western. And although a super cool piece of technology, allowed students to, you know, dissect over and over again without, you know, going through multiple cadavers, remove things like formaldehyde allergies and things like that. At the same time, there were accessibility issues that they didn't perceive in terms of, individuals who have light sensitivity that might have a traumatic brain injury or a concussion. The headsets could cause headaches themselves, or individuals that were prone to migraines. So we had to learn some workarounds. We had to work through seeing if somebody wore a headset and we video cast it to the person's laptop, how that worked. What we found is that for many, it will make you seasick. So we had to play around with that. So, I'm always excited about new technology, but I try to encourage agencies around campus or departments to think about including us in the discussion early on. Not saying you can't have the cool new toy, but let's think ahead at you know, what populations might not, you know, be serviced in the same way. Other experiences with technology and that has replaced previously hands-on learning?
I actually can give a quick example of how we use technology to create hands-on learning for a visually impaired student. So we had a student who was taking chemistry and had no vision at all. And so trying to describe chemistry, even with the best of faculty, it was a challenge for the student to really understand how things change and reform and what have you. And so they actually did a lot of 3D printing, and the student was at a distance. So we were mailing 3D models to the student to try to get some basic understanding of what was happening in the course. And it was really a changing moment for the student and for the faculty to really think through how such a visual course can be taught to a student who didn't have vision. So it was really helpful.
That's a great anecdote, Linda, and that's probably a really great way to wrap us up today. Emily added, what a neat and creative idea. So yeah, that's a perfect way to end today. And with no more folks jumping in, I just want to thank you both so much for being here and sharing your knowledge and leading this discussion. So thank everyone who is attending. Also, we greatly value everybody's participation and input, and we all have learned a lot from each other today. So thanks very much. I hope everyone has a wonderful weekend, and we will see you all next month at the next one of these. So everybody take good care in the meantime.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks everyone for coming.